The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from the God of their salvation.
Colossians 2 reminds us that we have been buried with Christ in baptism in order that we might be raised to new life with him through faith in the power of God. Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sin together. Merciful God, in your gracious presence, we confess our sin and the sin of this world. Although Christ is among us as our peace, we are a doubtful people who cling to the values of a broken world. We get stuck pretending we are okay. We dwell not on the eternal, but on the petty. We are disciples who forget your truths. Have mercy on us, O God, in your loving kindness. Reveal to us again the resurrection of Christ. Do not cast us away from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from us. Open our eyes to see you better and guide us in truth. Lord, in your mercy, hear all our prayers and forgive us, we pray. Amen. Do not fear, says the Lord, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. God is doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. By the grace of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you all. Let us share the peace with one another. And with you. Peace. Peace, Jen. Peace, Dennis. Good to see you. Peace, Ruth. Thank you. Peace. peace. Hey, looking forward back to that class. Peace. How are you doing? Good? Pretty good? Peace. 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 How are you? Good to see you.
Peace. All right. After you've shared your peace, children, come on down and join us, please. All right. All right, everybody. Peace be with you.
Mm-hmm. Oops, let me go up one.
All right. Come on down and join us. So, as humans, we're kind of breakable, aren't we? We're kind of fragile, right? We've got to wear a helmet when we're riding the bike and some guards when we're rollerblading or on the skateboard, right? Because sometimes we can get hurt. And when we get hurt, it can make scars on our body, right? And those scars sometimes can tell a story about what happened to us. I wonder if anyone here has a scar that's easy to see that you could show us and tell us a story. Okay, let's hear.
I have a scar on my neck that I banged it on a counter.
Oh, you banged it on a counter. I'm sorry to hear that. Let me take a look. Oh, yes. Okay, your turn.
I have a scar. Where is it? Right there, and I cut it on a brick.
Oh, you cut it on a brick. Wow, yep, that's a long one, and it looks pretty recent because it's really pink. All right, last one.
I actually had to get stitches, and it's right here.
Wow, yes. Wow, that was quite a boo-boo. You got stitches. You had to go to the hospital and everything. Yeah. You hit it on a metal pole, right? I have a scar too right here from about 10 years ago roller skating with my kids' elementary school. I went down and I broke my wrist, so I've got my own story to tell about that, right? Here's someone else who has a story to tell. Does anyone know who this is? Who's that young lady? It is Malala, right? Does anyone know Malala's story down here? Malala, who lived in Pakistan, can you see she has an injury on her head, right? And she probably has a considerable scar, right? Malala, she was going to school like so many girls do around the world, but where she lived, there were people who didn't want girls to go to school, and she was shot. But she has recovered. She has that scar and that story, but she went on to do important things in this world. Right? So being human means that sometimes we get hurt and sometimes we have a scar and a story to tell. And this ties in with today's scripture. I wonder if somebody would like to read this. We'll let Charlotte have a turn. You did wonderful at the call to worship.
Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. He showed them his hands and his feet.
Right, that is Jesus. Jesus was appearing to the disciples after he had risen from the dead. And he had scars. He was showing them those scars, and he even let them touch those scars. Why do you think he did this? Why was it important that he appeared to them with some scars on his body? Does anybody have any ideas why?
Yes. So they could know that he was Jesus?
So they could know that he was Jesus? Yeah, anything else? Yeah, Jack.
Maybe so they can know that he was hurt.
That he was
hurt.
That he was hurt. Yeah. So they knew that he was hurt.
That he had risen.
That he had risen. That he was the same person, right? The same person who they saw hurt, and that he was risen. But for that reason, I think maybe he didn't have those scars healed when he reappeared. He was showing them, hey, I was human too, just like you. I was a fragile person just like you, right? So the story, what is important to remember is that we are hurt, we have scars, but to be able to tell those stories like Jesus did, we are survivors. Jesus was a survivor. He was resurrected. That's his story, that it goes on. And all of us with our boo-boos and our scars, they tell the story of our survival. And as we keep going in life and keep following Jesus. All right, friends, thanks for coming up here today. I will take some of you over to the nursery and the rest can go back to your families or the tables.
Good morning. As you watch me switch from mom to preacher mode, it is so nice to be here today. Erin is so good at what she does. Thank you, Erin, for that awesome children's moment, right? She's so good at it. I asked the right person. Thank you for welcoming me back. I feel like I haven't been in the pulpit in a long time. It's really nice to be here, and it's always a privilege to be with you, my Peace Church family. You know we concluded the season of Lent. Easter was 2 weeks ago, but you may not also know that we are in the season of Easter. So we are actually still in the Easter season. I'm sure you're familiar with egg hunts we have as a tradition, but does anyone know about another kind of Easter egg? Any other like Easter eggs in like movies or social media? Yeah, somebody said, uh-huh. Okay, so for those of you who don't know, there are other things that are called Easter eggs. Easter eggs are secrets. Their tricks and their jokes hidden in pieces of media. Usually they're hard to spot, right? You're hunting for them like an Easter egg hunt. And they might reveal a new detail or clues about the story, or they're paying respect to an inspiration that creators loved. In our house, we love Pixar movies. And Pixar movies are a great example of finding Easter eggs in movies. So here are some examples of Easter eggs in Pixar movies. You see A113 all over the screen. A113 is an animator's inside joke. It actually refers to a specific classroom number at the California Institute of the Arts, where many of these Pixar people got their start. So they're paying respect to it in all of their movies. You see Woody over there in the top right. You see Joy in the top left there from Inside Out. There's some graffiti down there with Riley in the bottom left. That really small circle is Finding Nemo, and on the camera right there, it says A113. And then there's Flick in the bottom right, and Ants and A Bug's Life as he sets on this journey to save his colony. So those are examples, and now you can go home and watch a Pixar movie and look for A113 and you'll know, right? So that's an example of an Easter egg. Now, why am I talking about this? Because in our scripture today, we are in the middle of hunting for Easter Jesus. He's already shown up. He's already appeared to his disciples on the road to Emmaus. They were chatting about the hot news that Jesus had died and that they were hoping he'd be the Messiah to redeem Israel. All the while, the women at the tomb said Jesus' body had gone missing. So this news of Jesus and where he is, this is trending. This is the hot thing to be talking about. So they invite Jesus, who they don't know is Jesus, to stay with them. And then in the breaking of the bread, they realize that it's him. Easter egg, they found him. But then the moment they recognize him, poof, he vanishes from their sight, only to reappear in our scripture today. So we begin in the very last chapter of the Gospel of Luke, Luke chapter 24, verses 36b through 48. Let's listen for the word of God. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them, and he said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Yet, for all their joy, they were still disbelieving and wondering. And he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and then he took it and he ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead, and on the third day and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Will you join me in prayer? We thank you, God, for your word that is ancient and alive and true. We pray that your Holy Spirit would fall upon it, fall upon my words, fall upon all of our listening, that we may be your disciples whose minds are opened to understand the scriptures. We pray this in the name of the risen Christ. Amen. So what if, just like Easter eggs, children hunted for this peaceful path just 2 weeks ago, and just like the Easter eggs we can find in Pixar movies, we hunted for Easter Jesus. And I mean doing that this year, like now, 2024. What if we still were looking closely for signs of his whereabouts? Here's what our scripture reveals to us today. Here's my first point. Receive Jesus's peace when you're in grief and you need support. To give you a little context here, the disciples are not in the middle of a yoga retreat when Jesus appears. I don't imagine anyone is practicing deep breathing or mindfulness. These disciples are in a peace deficit, a peace drought. I truly think this moment in Scripture is meant to be amusing. Jesus just can't win here. The disciples are feverish with excitement and worry and doubt and uncertainty. And even if Jesus comes in with a soft, "Peace be with you," they're what? Startled, terrified, a ghost. But the writer of Luke here wants to make sure that we know Jesus is not a ghost. And I know there are some Bible nerds in this room. I'm one of them, and I know a number of you have been in my classes. And this is the funnest Bible nerd point of the whole sermon. The Greek word for ghost here is pneuma, which means spirit, which, by the way, they're about to receive at Pentecost in Acts. It's not actually phantasma, which is where we would get words like ghost, or you can even hear phantom. So Luke is using the word pneuma here, even though they think it's a ghost. And Luke likes this word, pneuma. Luke has used it very early on. It evokes the beginning of the gospel, during the beloved Magnificat, when Elizabeth is filled with pneuma, the spirit, and she blesses the pregnant Mary so much that Mary then sings her famous song, "My spirit, my pneuma, rejoices in God my Savior." So the disciples here at the end of this gospel think they're being scared with a phantom, a ghost. One more reason to ring alarm bells. But in reality, Easter Jesus is showing up here, and he's giving his spirit, his pneuma, to soothe these tired, worried, panicked, grief-stricken disciples. That is good news. That spirit empowers people, as it already did Elizabeth and Mary in the opening chapters of this gospel, and now it's going to empower them at the end of the gospel. Peace is given to those in grief who need support, and these disciples need support, y'all. They're unsure about what's happening. They have doubts. Have they just wasted the past years of their life following someone who is just rejected and not the Messiah? You know, I fear that our culture's gotten so busy and efficient and personalized that we look at each other and we think, you're either a transaction, you give me this, I give you that, okay, thanks, bye. Or we see each other as competition. Am I better than you? Am I doing better than you? I fear we constantly want to display just how well we're doing, and then the appearance of thriving becomes the goal, not wrestling honestly, not wrestling faithfully. And let's be honest, nobody wants to be in a position like this with the disciples. No one wants to be in the position of grief and needing peace and receiving support, and so we avoid it. One of my recent favorite authors is Kate Bowler, who just came out with this awesome devotional book I'd recommend to you. It's called Have a Beautiful, Terrible Day. And she's actually a Duke Divinity professor and a cancer patient. And then this is her prayer that I hope some of you can really put in your hearts when you need that peace. Lord, even you rested Even you gave yourself over to stillness, and like a pool of clear water, allowed peace to uncloud every gray sorrow. Every breath is your own making, God, in and out, in and out. Fill me with surprising calm. Fill me with the gentle nothingness of your quieting love. So if we're truly going to look for Easter Jesus, here's a clue. Look for those in grief. Look for those who need support. Our scripture today shows us that those who are lost, scared, and doubtful are the ones who are getting an Easter Jesus visit. Don't be so busy and so competent and so independent that you can miss him. You don't even recognize Easter Jesus. You want to know who's going to recognize him? Those in grief. Those who need support, they get Easter Jesus and his peace. So first we receive that peace Jesus is bringing when we're in grief and we need support. And now we get to play a little bit. Cultivate a childlike curiosity about Jesus. These verses remind me of children's show and tell time. As you know, and you saw, I am parenting Luke and Nathan. Luke is 9, Nathan's almost 6, and every Friday is almost like a holy day in kindergarten for our family. Nathan has show and tell every Friday, and he is not the kid who wings it last minute. No, he is given the prompt Monday morning, and then we spend days thinking about it. What is he going to bring, right? What are the features that we're going to show, how it rolls across the mat, all of these things. We really take this seriously in our family. And then a lot of thought goes into it, but I really think Easter Jesus here is having a show and tell. This is like a show and tell moment with Easter Jesus. So years ago when I was in seminary, I was asked to lead children's ministry on a medical mission trip to Ghana. Look at me, 16 years ago, I look so young. Look at that. Look at this little girl. So that's me in Ghana. I was asked to lead children's ministry on this medical mission trip. And we would go and set up all these different mobile sites. And without a doubt, there'd be a handful of kids who were just kind of hanging out there while their parents were eagerly waiting to get the care they needed and setting up the clinic. And then I'd walk up to those kids, this was every day for 2 weeks in a row, and I'd say, hey, kids, need something to do? Go get your friends. And it was sort of like a VBS, wherever the new site was every day in Ghana. Whew, y'all, they took that job seriously. It was maybe 4 kids about, and then within 10 minutes, it was truly over 100 children. Okay, luckily I had a team of people, but I had all of these kids suddenly, and I was going to keep them busy while their parents were getting the care and the help that they needed that they didn't usually have access to. So I'm keeping these kids busy, and we're having a blast, but I will say that they didn't really know me or trust me until they got very curious about me. And so the first thing they'd usually do, somebody who was really bold would kind of inch their way up, and then it was this. They really liked my hair. It was, oh, I got to feel that, you know. I'm gonna compare it to mine, then I'm going to go back to yours, right? And then, as they could tell, they could trust me, I'd kind of kneel down so they could reach me better. And then they would really get bold, and then they'd go for the skin. Ooh, your skin's a different color than mine, right? And then they'd go like this. And then they'd see if it smudged onto them, see if we could do a little swapping of color and skin tone. And it was all like this, and I just let them touch and get a hang of what I was like and see they could trust me. I let them get hands-on with me, and I realized that when I indulged their curiosity, I earned their trust. I earned their trust, and then usually one of them would sit in my lap, which is, you know, the best, to have that kind of trust with kids. So as disciples, we're invited to tap into that curiosity, to be hands-on. Jesus has invited them to be curious so that they'll trust him. They'll trust him. And by the way, Smarty Pants Presbyterians, that means not just staying smart and cerebral. And I like being smart and cerebral. But even Karl Barth said this. He said when children play properly, they do so with supreme seriousness and devotion. We, this is all of us of every age, are summoned to play properly. We cannot be more than children, God's children, engaged in serious and true play. No type of work is exempt from this rule. So you're not going to find Easter Jesus just by sitting around a table and having an argument about predestination. You're not going to find Easter Jesus just by quoting a book you've read I doubt the most effective way to find Easter eggs 2 weeks ago was to just sit on a bench or to look through a window, surmising the whereabouts and latitude and longitude of each egg. No, you're running around. You're getting dirt under your fingernails. Jesus is inviting them to show and tell. He's saying, look at my hands and my feet. Touch me. See my flesh. Watch my digestive system at work while I eat this broiled fish. He knows that indulging the disciples' curiosity is going to lead to trusting him. If you want to find the resurrected Christ this Easter, take a hands-on approach to Jesus. Try on ministries. Ask good questions. Don't take yourself too seriously. Be silly. Use your hands to touch. Use your feet to walk. Take a stance. Dance. Eat food with friends. Laugh. Cough. Cry. And when we lean into that humanity and we accept that curiosity, we invite Easter Jesus into our lives. And by the way, we're going to recognize Easter Jesus better when we're hands-on because we've indulged in that curiosity. Here's the last point, and it's the last verses of the scripture. We ought to accept help and teaching. So he's just showed off his human skills. He's had his show-and-tell moment. And now he transitions quickly into teacher mode. If I had to do my message version of this, he'd say, now, where do we leave off? Oh, yeah. Remember when I was with you a while back, and then I said everything about me from the old days, Moses, prophets, and the Psalms would be true? Well, yes. Right? That's what he's saying. And then something really special happens. Easter Jesus equips his disciples to not just be disciples, but, what's that word? Witnesses. Witnesses. And how does he do that? He opens their minds, and then they accept Jesus' help and teaching. Witnesses, as described in our scripture today, are just ordinary people whose minds are opened to accept Jesus' help and teaching. I think that we've gotten very narrow in our understanding of that word. Witnesses are not just the first on-the-scene bystanders who give an account about a crime or in a courtroom. Witnesses are ordinary people whose minds are open to accept Jesus' help and teaching. So witnesses are open to whatever God lays out next for them. Witnesses are the people who attend Alcoholics Anonymous. Witnesses are the people who we don't even know, who park their car here and who walk into that building for Samaritan counseling. And they're doing that all week long. Those are witnesses. Witnesses are the widow who's learning how to do her taxes for the first time. Witnesses are the parent who reaches out because of an addiction. Witnesses are the retiree who considers how they might be used by the Holy Spirit in the closing chapters of their life because they're not dead yet. I recently came across an article that described this really cool retired 82-year-old professor. He's super accomplished. He's affectionately called Mr. Gill, and he happened upon this second career. So in Modesto, California, Gill Howard became the go-to teacher for women from Afghanistan, where they were not allowed to drive. In recent years, he has taught over 400 women how to drive. Mr. Gill, as he is known, not Mr. Howard, Mr. Gill, provides free of charge opportunity for women to learn how to drive. And he is super in high demand. There's a list of over 50 women who want Mr. Gill to teach them how to drive in America. How did he get into this job? Well, he was moved by images of migrants who were drowning during attempts to cross the Mediterranean to reach the West. And so he said, World Relief put me to use. He became invested in families. And one day, one of the women said, hey, can you teach me how to drive? And he said, huh, all right, there's a parking lot right over there. And then the rest is history. Friends, when we accept Jesus' help and teaching, our minds are opened like the disciples. We could be like Mr. Gill, and we're given the opportunity to not only find the Easter Jesus, but then be equipped to help others and to point the good news of hope and resurrection. We are Jesus' witnesses who proclaim forgiveness and repentance. So, I don't know about you, but I have already hung up my Easter dress. I already washed my boys' green gingham Easter shirts. I've still of April now. I'm trying to think ahead to summer and finalizing summer plans, but please, Please let Easter Jesus stay in your mind. He is our hope. And just as he visited the scared disciples, he visits us. He offers us peace and comes near to those who need support. He invites us to be curious and to trust him, and then he teaches ordinary us how to be his witnesses. Jesus showed up, in and out, Easter egg Jesus, in and out in their lives, and he shows up in our lives today. So let's be on the lookout. Amen. Let's stand and sing. Can you remain standing as we affirm our faith from an excerpt in Henry Nouwen? Easter brings the awareness that God is present even when God's presence is not directly noticed. Easter brings the good news that although things seem to get worse in the world, the evil one has already been overcome. Easter allows us to affirm that although God seems very distant, and although we remain preoccupied with many little things, our Lord walks with us on the road and keeps explaining the scriptures to us. Thus, there are many rays of hope casting their light on our way through life. You may be seated. So according to Luke's gospel, after going for a long walk, we know Jesus sat down and ate with his friends, and then in taking the elements, the disciples' eyes were opened, and they recognized Jesus. So even in his resurrection, Jesus showed his disciples he wanted to eat with them, and Jesus wants to eat with us. He invites you to this table to eat with him. May we humbly accept this invitation. May we open our hearts to how he can help us understand his will better.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Praise to you, O God, for all your works. You created the world and you called it good, and you made all people in your image to live together in love. You made a covenant with us, even when we doubt and fail to understand, you remain ever faithful. Thank you, O God, for sending us Jesus. Jesus lived among us and told your story. He healed the sick and welcomed sinners. He shares our bodily pain and all those scars, and he died our death, and then rose to new life that we might live and all the creation be restored.
We give you thanks that the Lord Jesus, on the night before he died, took bread. And after giving thanks to you, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
And in the same way, Jesus took the cup and poured it out and said, "This is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. My covenant is sealed in this bread and this cup. And so whenever we drink of it, we do this in remembrance of him." Jesus, remembering your boundless love, we break the bread and share the cup in joy and praise of the life you lived. Gracious God, we ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they might be for us the body and blood of Christ that we need, that we may be able to go out and share this body in a hungry world. So by your Spirit, unite us with Christ and with one another. May your Spirit open our eyes to who may not feel welcome at the table today.
Widen our gaze to understand the depth of your grace until we feast with him and with all your saints in your eternal realm of justice and peace. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I'd like to remind you that we take communion by intinction. So as the servers come forward, you will take a piece of the bread and you'll dip it in the cup, and then you can return to your seat. We also have a gluten-free option available for those of you who prefer and need that. And also, we'd like to remind you of the privilege the Stephen ministers would have to intercede and pray for you back here in the narthex during the communion time.
Thank you. Let us pray. Lord, we pray for those for whom this is their day to be born, for those for whom this is their day to die, and for all of us for whom this seems just another day on life's path. Grant us the grace, we pray, to be good and firm companions along the way, and to find the Easter Jesus, even after Easter. And if it be your will, grant us the joy of knowing you as our best companion on the journey, and you as the home to which our journey leads. Lord, we pray for those who are desperately aware of their need for you today, for those who tragically are unaware of their need for you today, and for those of us who know our need for you, but who from time to time get so caught up in our own concerns that we forget who and whose we are. Bless us all, we pray, with the holy vision, with a transforming awareness of your presence with us, of your power in and around us, of your purpose at work in the world and in our lives, and of your peace at work in our hearts, our minds, our homes, our world, especially when we grieve. We ask prayers for those listed in the bulletin and those in our heart from whom we think about in silence, and also for Chip, a neighbor of Dee Romito, who is starting chemotherapy, Lauren, a friend of Dee's, whose death of her mother, Jeff Muckenfuss, who is having carotid stent installed on 422, for Susie Rogulski's dad, Lee, who is 97 and is in the hospital, and for Bill Lash, the great-grandmother of Emmeline and Jacob Pleakin, who is in his final days. Lord, we pray for those who are leaders in the church, in the world, in government, in culture, at work in our homes, and also for those who are led. Grant to all leaders, we pray, the inclination, the will, and the grace to lead as they would choose to be led, for those who are led to follow as they would choose to be followed, and to all of us, the wisdom to discern your leadership in whatever role we are called upon to play. Hear us as we pray together the prayer that your Son, Jesus Christ, taught us, saying,
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The calling to discipleship is a verse that the preaching pastor gets to pick as kind of your reminder for the week, the one you would write on a post-it, the one you would put on the refrigerator, the one you would change your phone screen to. So let's hear the words from Ephesians that Mary Beth wants us to hear. For once you were in darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness. Rather, expose them. For everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore, it says, note the exclamation point, sleeper, awake! Rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. So turn to your neighbor, find out their name. This is the person I want you to be praying for this week. Turn, say, hi, friend. I'm so-and-so. It's nice to see you today. This is the person you're taking from your Sunday worship experience into the rest of your life this week, and you're going to pray for that person by name at least once or twice. So maybe you chose the name of your spouse, and you get to see them every morning anyway. But maybe you just met a new friend. So visitors, welcome. We're glad you're here today. This is a community here at Peace that extends beyond just what we do here on Sunday morning. We are a community of worshipers that really look to our community, look to how we can be involved, look to areas of social justice, look to support our community of how we can bring the love of Christ into the world. So we're glad you're here. Visitors, we have a little, at the hospitality desk, we have a little gift for you. So come check it out, make sure we have your contact information, and we'd love to get in touch with you. Okay, what else do I have to do? Offering. Maybe you brought some money today that's just burning a hole in your pocket and you don't know where to put it. Well, let me tell you, you can put it in the offering plate. You can put it in one of the boxes up here. You can give online if you're at home. Give to the work of the church, give to the life of the church, give to the budget, give to all the ways that we need to get out into the world and share our offering. But most importantly, let's give our lives. Let's give our hearts. Let's give our minds. Will you pray with me? Dear God, once again, we are here on a Sunday morning, and we came to church needing to hear your word, and we heard it. So we ask that you stirred our hearts and stirred our minds, and that you motivated us to get out there into the world and to share your love and light. All that we have, we give to you. Let us serve the world in love. And God's people said, amen. Okay, it's time to stand and sing that final hymn. He is still among us. Please look for him. He shows up. He shows up when you need peace. He shows up and invites you to be curious, to try things on, to be childlike and have a childlike trust and know him better. And he encourages you and he empowers you to be his witnesses to offer forgiveness and repentance. So I invite you now to receive the final blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord lift the light of his countenance and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. Let's be seated for the closing song.